I've always been interested in insects from the time I was a child. By the time I was six, I knew I wanted to be a biologist, but I didn't really know what that entailed, obviously. Ta-da!
I can't imagine many young biologists would have imagined research that entailed this. In the Apalachicola National Forest, just south of Tallahassee, we get to watch Walter Tschinkel's distinctive brand of entomology in action. First, let's meet the ants.
This is one called Phorelius pruinosus, and they always make these trails. I call this site Ant Heaven. It has a very dense population of ants. That's actually why I came to work here, because there's an unusually large and dense population of Florida harvester ants. You can see that they decorate the nest with the charcoal they collect in the area. The charcoal they collect is mostly the burned end of pine needles, because this area, naturally, it would have burned every 2 or 3 years. Now the Forest Service does prescribe burns, not that often, but probably every 3 to 5 years.
They're always redecorating.
If you're going to ask me why do they do that, I'll have to tell you, I don't know. We've tested 8 different hypotheses at this point, and none of them were supported. So in the last 8 years, I've kept track of harvester ant colonies here at Ant Heaven. This is number 98, an old friend. This is a colony that I marked at least 8 years ago. But this is where it moved from. You can see this is what I call a ghost. So here you can see a still older ghost of the same colony. They move on average once a year. They don't move far. All they're doing is a random walk around some central spot. I know you're going to ask me why they move, and I have to tell you right at the outset, I don't know. I don't know why they move.
So here we have ants exhibiting behaviors that have no obvious survival benefit. But that's not the most surprising thing we learn about ants from Dr. Tschinkel's research.
You really only want one layer of charcoal around the outside, because everything else is wasted. The most recent project, which is why we're here today, is that I started working on the nest architecture of underground ant nests. What spaces do they create under there? And about 15 years ago, I developed some methods for making casts of those hollow spaces. And when you make a cast, it reveals even the tiniest details of the shape of that negative space, that empty space. This is sort of a cheating way of starting a fire. I remembered from college chemistry and physics, and actually the principle is very simple. If you're combusting material, if you want it to reach very high temperature, you have to contain the heat within the furnace. So now you can see the kiln is really cooking, and I think it's time to add the aluminum. This is the aluminum that we're putting in now. These are pieces of old scuba tanks that have failed the pressure test. We'll wait for that to melt, and we'll probably have to add more. I love that sound. That is good sound.
Conducting this research requires scientific knowledge beyond biology.
Science isn't really all that compartmentalized. We do teach it as biology, chemistry, physics, and so on. But in fact, the overlap among all those disciplines is really extreme. If you want to build a kiln, you have to know a little bit of chemistry. You have to know some physics, like, you know, gas laws and combustion and those kinds of things. And then basically it's a question of solving problems. And here we go. And I like to spread my legs wide so I don't get scorched. Oh, my pants are almost on fire.
It hardens quickly.
Keeps you fit. Yeah, it is. It can be fractured. Fractured fractal.
The metal didn't reach all the way to the bottom, so he pours again and digs deeper.
I had dug up a lot of fire ant nests, and I thought I knew just from the cross sections of digging and so on how the space was organized underground. But when I made a cast, I found out that I was wrong, that instead of a sort of a chaotic swarm of chambers, they were actually quite strictly organized into vertical shafts and horizontal chambers. That was quite an epiphany. And after that, I started casting other species to see what they looked like. And of course, every time you do another new species that you haven't done before, it's always a surprise.
Dr. Tschinkel now makes casts of the 100 or so local species found in the Apalachicola National Forest. These are the castings featured in his current exhibit at the Tallahassee Museum.
Well, it's an interesting line of work, and it never fails to reward, actually.
For WFSU, I'm Rob Diaz de Villegas.